city, in fair Verona where we lay our scene. From ancient grudge break to new mutiny, where civil blood makes civil hands unclean. From forth the fatal loins of these two foes, a pair of star-crossed lovers take their life, whose misadventured, piteous overthrows do with their death bury their parents' strife. The fearful passage of their death-marked love and the continuance of their parents' rage, which, but their children's death not could remove, is now the 2 hours' traffic of our stage. The which, if you with patient ears attend, what here shall miss, our toil shall strive to mend.
Feel no love in this. Farewell, my cousin.
Soft.
love.
What, shall I groan and tell thee?
Groan? Why no? But sadly, tell me who.
In sadness, cousin, I do love a woman.
I am so near when I suppose you love.
A right good markman, and she's fair, my love.
All right, fair mark, fair cause, as soon as tip.
Well, in that hit, you miss. She'll not be hit with Cupid's arrow. She hath Dian's wit, and in strong proof of chastity, well armed. From love's weak, childish bow, she lives unharmed. She will not stay the siege of loving terms, nor bide the encounter of assailing eyes, nor overlap to saint seducing gold. Oh, she is rich in beauty, only poor, that when she dies with beauty, dies her store.
And she has thrown that she'll still live chaste.
She hath, and in that sparing makes huge waste. She is too fair, too wise, wisely too fair, to merit bliss by making me despair. She hath forsworn to love, and in that vow do I live dead, but live to tell it now.
Be ruled by me, forget to think of her.
Oh, teach me how I should forget to think.
By giving lip key unto thine eyes, examine other beauties.
Tis the way to call hers exquisite and question more. Farewell. Thou canst not teach me to forget.
I'll pay that doctor, or else die in death.
But now, my lord, what say you to my suit?
But saying over what I have said before, my child is yet a stranger in the world. She hath not seen the change of 14 years. Let two more summers wither in their pride ere we may think her ripe to be a bride.
Younger than she are happy mothers made.
And too soon marred are those so early made. But woo her, gentle Paris, get her heart. My will to her consent is but a part. And she agree within her scope of choice, lies my consent in fair according voice. This night I hold an old accustomed feast, whereto I have invited many guests, such as I love, and you among the store, one more most welcome makes my number more. Come, go with me. Go, sirrah, trudge about through fair Verona, and find those persons out, whose names are written here, and to them say, my house and welcome on their pleasure stay.
To supper, to our house.
Who
whose house?
I'm Esther's.
Indeed, I should have asked you that before.
And now I'll tell you without asking. My master is the great, rich Capulet. And if you be not of the house of Montagues, come and fresh a cup of wine. Rest and merry.
At this same ancient feast of Capulets, sups the fair Rosaline whom thou lovest. With all the admired beauties of Verona, go thither and, with unattained eye, compare her face to some that I will show, and I will make thee think thy swan a crow.
One fairer than my love? The all-seeing sun ne'er saw her match since first the world began.
Tough, you saw her fair in an else being by, herself forced herself in either eye. But in that crystal scales, let there be weighed your lady's love against some other maid, that I will show you shining at this feast, and she shall scant show well that now shows best.
I'll go along. No such sight to be shown, but to rejoice in splendor of mine own.
Follow me.
Juliet, happy days. Go, girl. Happy nights. The happy days. dancing shoes with nimble soles. I have a soul of lead, so stakes me to the ground, I cannot move.
You are a lover. Borrow Cupid's wings and soar with them above the common bough.
I am to soar and pierce it with his shaft, to soar with his light feathers. And so bound, I cannot round a pitch above dull woe.
Under love's heavy burden do I sink. Learn to sink in it, should you burden love.
Great oppression for a tender thing.
Is love a tender thing? It is too rough, too rude, too boisterous,
and it pricks like thorns.
If love be rough with you, be rough with love. Prick love for the pricking should you beat love down. Give me a case to put my visage in, a visor for a visor. What care I, what curious eye doth quote deformities? Here the beetle brow shall blush for me.
Come, knock and enter, and no sooner in, every man can
think whose legs. I mean me well in going to this mask. But 'tis not wit to go.
What, may one ask?
I dreamed a dream tonight.
And so did I.
Well, what was yours?
The dreamers often lie.
In bed asleep, well, they do dream things true.
Oh, I see. Queen Mab has been with you. She's the fairest midwife and comes in a shape no bigger than an agate stone on the forefinger of an alderman, drawn by a team of little atomies, athwart men's noses as they lie asleep. Her wagon spokes, made of long spider's legs. Her wagoner, a small gray-coated gnat, not so big as a round little worm, pricked from the lazy finger of a maid. In this state, she travels, night by night, through lovers' brains, and they dream of love, over courtiers' knees, who dream of curtsies straight, over lawyers' fingers, who straight dream on fees, over ladies' lips, who straight on kisses dream, which are the angry man with blisters plays, because their breasts with sweetened stained are. Sometimes she gallops over courtier's nose, and dreams he of smelling out a suit. And comes she with a thy pig's tail, tickling a parson's nose as lies asleep. And dreams he of another benefit. Sometimes she draggeth over a soldier's neck, and dreams he of cutting for a throat. Of heaths 5 fathoms deep, and then anon drums in his ear, at which he starts and wakes, and thus, being frightened, swears a prayer or two, and sleeps again. This is the very man that plats the manes of horses in the night, and bakes the elf locks and foul sluggish hairs, which, once untangled, much misfortune bodes. This is the hag that the maids lie on their backs, presses them, and learns them first to bear, making them women of good carriage. This is she!
Peace, Mercutio, peace. Thou talkest of nothing.
True, I talk of dreams, which are but the children of an idle brain. They got of nothing but vain fantasy, as thin of substance as the air, and as inconstant as the wind who woos even now the frozen bosom of the north, turning her face to the dew-dropping south.
This wind you talk of blows us from ourselves. Supper is done, and we shall come too late.
I fear too early, for my mind misgives some consequence, yet hanging in the stars, shall bitterly begin his fearful date with this night's revels, and expire the term of a despised life closed in my breast by some vile forfeit of untimely death. But he that hath the steerage of my course, direct my sail. On, blessed gentlemen.
Strike, drama.
Welcome, gentlemen. Ladies that have their toes unclaved with corns will have a bout with you. Aha, my mistresses, which of you all will now deny to dance? She that makes dainty, she all swear hath corns. Am I come near you now?
Welcome, gentlemen. I have seen the day that I have worn a visor and could tell a whispering tale in a fair lady's ear such as would please. Tis gone, tis gone, tis gone. You are welcome, gentlemen. Come, musicians, play! A hall, give room and foot it, girls!
Thank you. teach the torches to burn bright. It seems she hangs upon the cheek of night, like a rich jewel in an Ethiopian, beauty too rich for use, for earth too dear. Did my heart love till now? Forswear at sight, for I ne'er saw true beauty till this night.
This, by his voice, should be enough. Now by the stock and honor of my kin, to strike him dead, I hold it not a sin.
How now, kinsman, wherefore storm yourself?
Uncle, this is a Montague, our foe, a villain that is hither come in spite, to scorn at our solemnity this night.
Young Romeo, is it?
Romeo.
Content be, gentle cuz, let him alone. He bears him like a portly gentleman, and to say truth, Verona brags of him to be a virtuous and well-governed youth. Therefore, take no note of him. Be patient. It is my will, which if thou respect, show a fair presence, and put off these frowns and ill-beseeming semblance for a feast.
Such a villain as a guest, I'll not cure him.
He shall be endured.
My uncle, 'tis a shame.
Go to, you are a saucy boy. Is it so indeed? This trick my chance to scheme you. I know what, you must contrary me. Marry, 'tis time. You are a princox, go.
Be quiet, or
more light. For shame I'll make you quiet. Watch cheerily, my hearts.
Shall withdraw, for this intrusion shall, now seeming sweet, convert to bitter gall.
If I profaned with my unworthiest hand this holy shrine, the gentle sin is this. My lips, two blushing pilgrims, ready stand to smooth that rough touch with a tender kiss.
Good pilgrim, you do wrong your hands too much. Which manly devotion shows in this, for saints have hands that pilgrims' hands to be cut, and palm for palm is holy palmers' care.
Have not saints' lips and holy palmers too?
Aye, pilgrim, lips that they must use in prayer.
Oh, then, dear saint, let lips do what hands do. They pray, grant thou, lest faith turn to despair.
Saints do not move, though grant your prayers take.
Then move not, while my prayers effect I take. Thus, from my lips, by yours, my sin is purged.
Then have my lips the sin that they have took.
Sin from my lips? Oh, trespass sweetly urged. Give me my sin again.
The kiss by the book.
Put on. Your mother craves a word.
What is her mother?
Her mother is the lady of the house and at times with a virtue of soul. That is her daughter with whom we talk at all. But I will tell you, any man that can lay a hold of her shall have the cheeks.
Is she a Capulet? Oh, dear account! My life is my foe's debt!
Away, be gone, this orders of the best.
I fear the war is my unrest!
Come hither, nurse! What is yon gentleman?
His name is Romeo, a Montague, and the only son of your greatest enemy.
My only love sprung from my only hate. Too early seen unknown, and known too late. Oh, prodigious birth of love it is to me, that I must love a loved enemy.
What's this?
A rhyme I learned even now, a one I danced with all.
Juliet! Anon, let's go to the stranger's home.
Can I go forward when my heart is here?
Romeo, my cousin Romeo.
He is wise, and upon my life hath stolen him home to bed.
He ran this way and left this orchard wall. Call, good Mercutio.
Call? Nay, I'll conjure too. Romeo!
Humors, madman.
Passion, lover.
Appear thou to us in the likeness. Sigh. Speak but one rhyme, and I am satisfied. Cry, I, me, pronounce for love, and a dove. He here hears not, he stirs not, he moveth not, the ape is dead. Yet I must conjure him. I conjure thee by Rosalind's bright eyes, by her high forehead and scarlet lip, that in her likeness thou appear to us.
And if he hear thee, thou wilt anger him. Come, he hath hid himself among these trees, to be consorted with the humorous knight. Why does this loft and best befits the dark?
Come, Benvolio, out to my truckle bed. This feeble bed is too cold for me to sleep. Come, shall we go?
Go then, for 'tisn't big. The sycamore means not to be found.
He just set scars that never felt a wound. What's up? What light through yonder window breaks? It is the east, and Juliet is the sun. Arise, fair sun, and kill the envious moon, who is already sick and pale with grief, that thou, her maid, art far more fair than she. It is my lady. Oh, it is my love. Oh, that she knew she were. She speaks. Yet she says nothing. What of that? Her eye discourses. I will answer it. I am too bold. It is not to me she speaks. Two of the fairest stars in all the heavens, having some business, do entreat her eyes to twinkle in their spheres till they return. What if her eyes were there, they in her head? The brightness of her cheek would shame those stars, as daylight doth a lamp. Her eye in heaven would through the airy region stream so bright that birds would sing and think it were not night. See how she leans her cheek upon her hand. Oh, that I were a glove upon that hand, that I might touch that cheek.
I mean,
she speaks. Oh, speak again, bright angel, for thou art as glorious to this night, being o'er my head, as is a winged messenger from heaven unto the white, upturned, wondering eyes of mortals that fall back to gaze on him when he bestrides the lazy pacing clouds and sails upon the bosom of the air.
Oh, Romeo, Romeo, wherefore art thou Romeo? Deny thy father and refuse thy name, or if thou wilt not, be but sworn my love, and I will no longer be a Capulet.
Shall I hear more, or shall I speak of this?
'Tis but thy name that is my enemy. Thou art thyself, and not a Montague. What is a Montague? It is nor hand, nor foot, nor arm, nor face, nor any other part belonging to a man. Be some other name, that which we call a rose, by any other name, would smell as sweet as Romeo would, were he not Romeo called, retain that dear perfection to which he owes without that title. Romeo, doff thy name, and for that name which is no part of thee, take all myself.
I take thee at thy word! Call me but love, and I'll be new baptized. Henceforth I never will be Romeo.
What man art thou that thus bescreened in night so stumblest on my counsel?
By a name, I know not how to tell thee who I am. My name, dear saint, is hateful to myself because it is an enemy to thee. Had I it written, I would tear the word.
My ears have not yet drunk 100 words of that tongue's utterance. Yet I know the sound. Art thou not Romeo and a Montague?
Neither, fair saint, if I did thee dislike.
How camest thou hither? And tell me, wherefore? The orchard walls are high and hard to climb. And thy place death, considering who thou art, if any of my kinsmen find thee here.
With love's light wings did I o'erperch these walls, for stony limits cannot hold love out. What love can do that dares love attempt? Therefore thy kinsmen are no let to me.
If they do see thee, they will murder thee.
Alack, there lies more peril in look thou but sweet, and I am proof against their enmity.
I would not for the world they saw thee here.
I have knight's cloak to hide me from their sight. And but thou love me, let them find me here. My life were better ended by their hate than death prorogued wanting of thy love.
Thou knowest the mask of night is on my face, else would a maiden blush but paint my cheek. For that which thou hast heard me speak tonight, fain would I dwell on form, fain deny what I have spoke. But farewell compliment. Dost thou love me? I know thou wilt say aye, and I will take thy word. Yet if thou swearest, thou mayest prove false. I lovers perjurers, then say, Jove laughs. O gentle Romeo, if thou dost love, then pronounce it faithfully. Or, if thou thinkest I am too quickly won, I'll frown and be perverse, and say thee nay. So thou wilt woo. But else not for the world. In truth, fair Montague, I am too fond, and therefore thou mayest think my behavior light. But trust me, gentlemen, I will prove more true than those that have more cunning to be strange. I should have been more strange, I confess. But that thou overheardest ere I was ware my true love's passion. Therefore pardon me, and did not impute this yielding to light love, which the dark night hath so discovered.
Lady, by yonder blessed moon, I swear, the tips with silver all these fruit tree tops.
Swear not by the moon, the inconstant moon, that monthly changes in her circled orb, lest that thy love prove likewise variable.
What shall I swear by?
Do not swear at all, or if thou wilt, swear by the by thy gracious self, which is the god of my idolatry. And I'll believe thee.
If my heart's dear love...
Well, do not swear. Although I joy in thee, I have no joy of this contract tonight. It is too rash, too unadvised, too sudden, too like the lightning, which doth cease to be ere one can say, it lightens. Sweet, good night. This bud of love, by summer's ripening breath, may prove a beauty's flower when next we meet. Good night, good night. To sweet repose and rest, come to thy heart as that within my breast.
Oh, wilt thou leave me so unsatisfied?
What satisfaction canst thou have tonight?
The exchange of thy love's faithful vow for mine.
But I did give thee mine before thou didst request it, and yet I would were it to give again.
Wouldst thou withdraw it? For what purpose, love?
But to be frank and give it thee again, and yet I wish but for the thing I have. My bounty is as boundless as the sea, my love as deep. The more I give to thee, the more I have, for both are infinite.
Ta-da!
I hear some noise within. Dear love, adieu. Anon, good nurse! Sweet Montague, be true. Stay but a little, I will come again.
Oh, blessed night! I am afeard, being in night. All this is but a dream, too flattering and sweet to be substantial.
Three words, dear Romeo, and good night indeed. If that thy bent of love be honorable, thy purpose marriage, then send me word tomorrow by one that I'll procure to come to thee, where and what time thou wilt perform the rite. And all my fortunes at thy foot I'll lay, and follow thee, my lord, throughout the world.
Ta-da!
I come anon, but if thou meanest not well, I do beseech thee.
Ta-da!
By and by I come to cease thy suit and leave me to my grief. Tomorrow I will send.
So thrive my soul.
A thousand times good night.
A thousand times the worst to want by light. Love goes toward love as schoolboys from their books. But love from love toward school with heavy looks.
Hiss, Romeo, hiss. Oh, for a falconer's voice to lure this gentle tassel back again. Bondage is hoarse and may not speak aloud, else would I tear the cave where Echo lies, and make her airy tongue more hoarse than mine with repetition of my Romeo's name.
It is my soul that calls upon my name. How silver sweet sound lovers' tongues by night, like softest music to attending ears.
Romeo,
my dear,
at what o'clock tomorrow shall I send to thee?
At the hour of nine.
I will not fail, 'tis 20 years till then. I have forgot why I did call thee back.
Let me stand here till thou remember it.
I shall forget to have thee still stand there, remembering how I love thy company.
And I'll still stay, to have thee still forget, forgetting any other home but this.
'Tis almost morning. I would have thee gone, yet no further than a wanton's bird, who lets it hop a little from her hand, and with a silk thread plucks it back again, like a poor prisoner in his twisted guise, so loving, jealous of his liberty.
I would I were thy bird, sweet.
So would I. Yet I should kill thee with much cherishing. Good night, good night. Parting is such sweet sorrow that I shall say good night till it be morrow.
Sleep, dwell in thine eyes, peace in thy breast. Would I were sleep and peace so sweet to rest. Hence will I to my ghostly father's cell, his health to crave, and my dear hap to tell.
The gray-eyed morn smiles on the frowning night, checkering the eastern clouds with streaks of light. Now, ere the sun advance his burning eye, the day to cheer and night's dank dew to dry, I must upfill this osier cage of ours with baleful weeds and precious dews and floods. The earth that's nature's mother is her tomb, but is her buried grave that is her womb. And from her womb, children of diverse kind be sucking on her natural bosom fine. None but for some, and yet all different. Oh, fickle is the powerful grace that lies in herbs, plants, stones, and their true qualities. For not so vile on earth doth live, but to the earth some special good doth give, nor aught such good, but strain from that fair use, revolt from true birth, stumbling on abuse. Virtue itself turns vice, being misapplied, and vice sometimes by action dignified. Within the infant rind of this small flower, poison hath residence and medicine power. For this be smelt, with that part cheers each part, being tasted, slays all senses with the heart. To such opposed kings and count them still in men as well as herbs, grace and rude will, and where the worser is predominant, full soon the canker death eats up that plant.
Good morrow, father.
Benedict Day, what early tongue so sweet salute gives me, young son? Argue the distempered head so soon bid good morrow to thy head, to thy bed. Care keeps his watch in every old man's eye. Where care lodges, sleep will never lie. But where unbruised youth with unstuffed brain doth couch his limbs, there golden sleep doth reign. Therefore, thy earliness doth assure me thou art aroused by some distemperature. Or, if not so, then here at pitch bright our Romeo hath not been bed tonight.
That last is true. The sweeter rest was mine.
God pardon, sin was thou with Rosaline.
With Rosaline, my ghostly father? No! I have forgot that name, and that name's woe.
That's my good son, but where hast thou been,
man? I'll tell thee ere thou ask it me again. I have been feasting with my enemy. Then plainly know my heart's dear love is set on the fair daughter of rich Capulet. Is my one hers is all mine, and all combined, save what thou hast combined, by holy marriage. When and where and how we met, we wooed and made exchange of vow, I'll tell thee as we pass, but this I pray, that thou consent to marry us today.
Holy Saint Francis, what a change is here. This Rosaline, whom thou didst love so dear, so soon as it can. Young men's love that lies not truly in their hearts, but in their eyes. Yea, see, Maria, what the deal of Brian have washed thy sallow cheeks for Rosaline. How much salt water thrown away in waste the season's love that of doth not taste. The sun
laying one and another out to have.
I pray thee, chide not. She whom I love now, the grace for grace and love for love, allow the other did not so.
She knew well thy love did read my rote and could not spell.
But come.
Young weaver, come.
Go with me.
In what respect? All I ask of thee for this alliance may so happy prove to turn your household's rancor to pure love.
Oh, let it hurt! I stand in such pain!
Wisely and slowly they stumble and run fast.
Why the devil should this Romeo be? Take me up home tonight.
Not to his father's, he spoke with his man.
That same pale hearted wench that Rosalind torments him so that he will sure run mad.
Tybalt, the kinsman of old Capulet, hath sent the letter to his father's house.
Shut up! On my life!
Romeo will answer it.
Any man that might write can answer a letter.
Nay, he will answer the letter's master, how he dares being dared.
Alas, poor Romeo, he's already dead. Stabbed, with a white quenched black eye, shot through the ear with a love song, very pain in his heart, cleft with a blind bone boy's butt shaft.
Yet is he a man to account for Tybalt?
Why, what is Tybalt?
More than a prince of cats, I can tell you. He's been captain of compliments. He fights you, same pricks off, keeps time, distance, and proportion. Rest me his men of rest. One, two, and a third in your bosom, the very butcher of a silk button. The gentleman of the very first house. Ah, the immortal Pisado, the punto reverso, the high!
Here comes Romeo, Grand Romeo.
Signor Romeo, bonjour. There's a French salutation for your French song. You gave us the counterfeit fairly last night.
Good morrow to you both.
What counterfeit did I give you? The slip, sir, the slip. Can you not conceive?
Pardon, good Mercutio. My business was great, and in such a case as mine, a man makes great courtesy.
In such a case as yours, constrains a man to bow the hand.
Meaning to curtsy.
Thou hast most kindly hit it.
A most courteous exposition.
I'm the very pink of courtesy.
Pink for flower.
Right.
Why then is my pump well flowered?
Come between us, good Benvolio, my wit's faint.
Switching spurs, we'll pray match.
I whiz round the wild goose chase I have done. That was more of the wild goose and one of thy wits than I had in my whole five. Was I with you there for the goose?
Oh, thou wast not there for anything when thou wast not there for the goose.
I was plenty in the ears that
chase. Take a goose, but not!
Here's a wit of shatter all the stretches from an inch narrow to an ell broad.
Yeah, for that word broad, adding to the goose privacy, far and wide, a broad goose.
Is this not better than groaning for love? Now thou art sociable. Now thou art Romeo. Now art thou what thou art, by art as well as nature.
Here's goodly gear.
A sail, a sail.
Goo, a curtain, a small.
Peter, and I have my fan, Peter.
Good Peter. To hide her face, for
her fan is the fairer face. Mm.
Good morrow, gentlemen. Good day, fair gentlewoman.
Is it good then?
Tis no less, for the body end of the dial is now upon the prick of noon.
Occupied, what a man are you?
A gentleman. One gentlewoman that God had made for himself tomorrow.
For himself tomorrow? You say well. Gentlemen, can any one of you tell me where I may find the young Romeo?
I can tell you, but young Romeo will be older when you have found him than he was when you sought him. I am the youngest of that name, for fault of horse.
You say well.
Yeah, he's the worst well. Very well took in faith, wisely.
Well, if you be he, sir, I desire some confidence with you.
She will invite him to some supper.
I will follow you.
Farewell, ancient lady. Farewell,
Scurvy knave, I'm none of his flirt gills, I'm none of his skein's baits.
Now, before God, I am so vexed that every part about me quivers. Scurvy maid. Now, as I did tell you, my young lady made me inquire about her. But what she bade me tell you, I will keep to myself, for I will pass on some information. Now, if you be leading the young gentlewoman into any sort of fool's paradise, as they say, it would be a very gross kind of behavior, as they say. But the gentleman is young, and any sort of dealing would be very weak dealing.
Nurse, commit me to thy lady and mistress. I do protest unto thee.
Peace be done. I will tell her lord, she will be a happy woman.
What wilt thou tell her, nurse? Thou dost not mark me.
I will tell her, but thou must protest, which I take it is a very gentlemanlike offer.
Bid her devise some means to come to shrift this afternoon. There she shall at Friar Lawrence's cell be shrived and married. Here's for thy pains.
Oh, truly, sir, not a penny.
Go to, I say you shall.
Well, shame, you say? Well, she shall be there.
And stay, good nurse, behind the abbey wall. Within this hour my man will be with thee, and bring thee cords made like a tackled stair, which to the high top gallon of my joy must be my convoy in the secret night. Farewell. Be trusty, and I'll quit thy ways. Pace. Farewell. Can we meet to thy mistress?
Aye, a thousand times.
Peter,
and I
take my fan and go for a piece.
The clock struck 9 when I did send the nurse. In half an hour, she promised to return. Perchance she cannot meet him. No, that is not so. Oh, she is lame. Love's herald should be thoughts which 10 times faster glide than the sun's beams, dropping back shadows over lowering hills. Therefore do nimble pinion doves draw love, and therefore hath the wind swift Cupid wings. Now is the sun upon the highmost hill of this day's journey, and from 9 till 12 is 3 long hours, yet she has still not come. Had she affections and warm youthful blood, she would be as swift in motion as a ball. My words would bandy her to my love, and his to me. But old folks may feign as they were dead, unwieldy, slow, heavy, and pale as lead. Oh, God. She comes! Oh, honey nurse! What news? Now, good nurse, or me. I look so sad. The news be sad, yet tell them merrily. If good, no shame was the music of sweet news by playing it to me with so sour a face.
Oh, I am a weary. Give me leave a while. Fie, how my bones ache.
I would pass my bones and I thy news.
Nay, come, I pray thee, speak, good nurse. Oh, can thou not stay a while? Hazy Maria, I am out of breath.
How art thou out of breath? When thou hast breath to say to me that thou art out of breath. Is thy news good or bad? Answer to that. Say either, and I'll stay the circumstance. Let me be satisfied. Is it good or bad?
Well, you know not how to choose a man. Romeo, no, not you. Though his face be better than most men's, though his leg excels all men's, and for hand and a foot and a body, though they not be talked upon, they are passing there. He is not the flower of courtesy, but I warrant as gentle as a lamb. What, have you done to tell him?
No, but all of this I did know before. What says he of our marriage? What of that?
Fie, how my head aches. It beats as it would fall in 20 pieces. What a head have I? And my back, oh, my back. Ah, the other side. Yes. Beshrew your heart for sending me to catch my death from jotting up and down.
I faith, I am sorry thou art not well. Sweet, sweet, sweet nurse, tell me, what says my love?
Your love says, like an honest gentleman, and a wise, and a kind, and a virtuous. Where's your mother?
Where is my mother? Why, she is within, where else should she be? How oddly thou repliest, your true love says, like an honest gentleman, where is thy mother?
Our ladies, God dear, are you so hot? Is this the poultice for my aching bones? Well, have you got leave to go to shrift today?
I have.
Hie you hence to Friar Lawrence's cell. There stays a husband to make you a wife.
I must another way to fetch the ladder by which your love shall climb soon when it is dark. Go, hie to the cell.
Hie, hie, hence. Honest nurse, farewell.
So smile the heavens upon this holy act that after hours with sorrow tide us not.
Amen. Amen. But come what sorrow can, it cannot countervail the exchange of joy that one short minute gives me in her sight. Do thou but close our hands with holy words, then love devouring death, do what he dare. It is enough I may but call her mine.
These final delights have final ends, and in their triumph die like fire and powder, which as they kiss, consume. Sweet honey is loathsome in its own deliciousness, and in the haste confounds the appetite. Therefore, love moderately. Long love doth so. Too swift arrives, too tardy is too slow. Here comes the lady.
Oh, delightful. Oh, there we out the everlasting flint.
A lover may bestride the gossamers that idle in the wanton summer air, yet not long. So light is vanity.
Good evening to my ghostly confessor.
Romeo shall thank me, die before us both.
As much to him, else is his thanks too much.
Ah, Juliet, if the measure of thy joy be heaped like mine, and let thy skill be more to blazon it, then sweeten with thy breath this neighbor air, and let rich music's tongue unfold the imagined happiness that both receive and either by this dear encounter.
Conceit more rich in matter than in words, brags of his substance, but not of ornament. They are but beggars that can count their worth. But my true love has grown to such excess that I cannot sum up some half my wealth.
Come, and we will make short work, for by your leaves you shall not stay alone till Holy Church incorporates who and what.
I pray thee, good Refugio, let's retire. The day is hot, the Capulets are abroad. And if we meet, we shall not escape a brawl. For now, these hot days, is the mad blood stirring.
Say, thou art a bloke of men, who upon entering the confines of the tavern, claps his sword upon the table and says, God send me no need of thee! And, by the operation of the second cup, draws the drawer that indeed there is no need.
Am I like such a fellow?
Nay, come, come, thou art as hot as Jack in London as any in Italy.
Too soon moved to be moody? Too soon moody to be moved?
And what to?
Nay, and there are two such. We should have none shortly, for one would kill the other. Thou wilt quarrel the man that hath one hair more, or one hair less, in fear, than thou hast. Thou wilt quarrel the man for cracking nuts, for no reason other than thou hast hazel eyes. But I, with such an eye, could spy out such a quarrel. Thou hast quarreled with the man for coughing in the street, because he hath whipped thy dog that hath legs in the sun. Thou dost not fall out with a tailor from his new doublet before Easter, and with another for tying his new shoes with an old ribbon, and yet you tutor me from quarreling.
By my head, here comes a Capulet.
By my heel, I care not.
Gentlemen, bid them. Word would tell you.
One word? Couple it with something, make it a word and a blow.
You shall find the appetite for that, sir, and you will give me an occasion.
Canst thou not take some occasion without giving?
Mercutio, thou consort with Romeo.
We talk here in the public haunt of men. Either withdraw unto some private place and reason coldly your grievances, or else depart. Here all eyes gaze on us.
Men's eyes were made to watch. Let them gaze. I will not budge for no man's pleasure. I.
Well, peace be with you, sir. Here comes my man. Romeo, the love I bear thee can afford no better than business. Thou art a villain.
Tybalt, the reason that I have to love thee doth much excuse the appertaining rage to such a greeting. Villain am I none. Therefore, farewell. I see thou knowest me not.
Boy, it shall not excuse the injuries thou hast done me. Therefore, turn and draw.
I do protest I never injured thee, but love thee better than thou canst devise, till thou shalt know the reason of my love. And so, good Capulet, which name I tender dearly as mine own,
Be satisfied.
Oh, calm this honorable vile submission. Tell me, you rat catcher. Will you walk?
What would survive me?
Good king of cats. Nothing but one of your nine lives.
I am for you.
Come, sir, your passado.
By and by comes back to Romeo, who had newly entertained revenge. and to it they go like lightning four, ere I could draw to part them, with stout Tybalt's sled. And as he fell, did Romeo turn and fly. This is the truth, there let Benvolio die.
He is a kinsman to the Montague. Affection makes him false, he speaks not true. I beg for justice, which thou prince must give. Romeo slew Tybalt, Romeo must not live.
Romeo slew him, he slew Mercutio. Who now the price of his dear blood doth owe?
Not Romeo, prince. He was Mercutio's friend. His fault concludes but what the law should end, the life of Tybalt.
And for that offense, immediately we do exile him hence. I will be deaf to pleading and excuses, nor tears nor prayers shall purchase out abuses. Therefore, use none. Let Romeo hence in haste, else when he's found, that hour is his last.
This logic, such a wagoner as Phaeton would whip you to the west and bring in cloudy night immediately, spread like closed curtain love performing night, that runaway eyes may wake and Romeo leaps these arms untalked of and unseen. Lovers can see to do their amorous rites by their own beauties, where fluffy blind it best agrees with the night. Come, simple knight, thou sober suited matron, all in black, and learn me how to lose a winning match played for a pair of stainless maidenhoods. Hood my unmanned blood, bathing my cheeks with thy black mantle, till strange love grown bold, think true love acted simple modesty. Come, night, come, Romeo, come, thou day in night, and thou wilt lie upon the wings of night, whiter than new snow on a raven's back. Come, gentle night, come, loving, black-browed night, give me my Romeo, and when he shall die, take him and cut him out into little stars, and he shall make the face of heaven so fine that all of the world will be in love with the night and pay no worship to the garish sun. Oh, here comes my nurse, and she brings news, and every tongue that speaks for Romeo's name speaks heavenly echoes. What hast thou there? The cords that Romeo bid thee fetch?
Aye,
aye. Tell me, what news? Why dost thou wring thy hands?
Oh, he's dead! He's dead! Alas, the day he's dead!
Can heaven be so envious?
Heaven can't, but Romeo cannot.
Oh, Romeo, Romeo, who would have thought? Romeo! What devil art thou that dost torment me thus? If Romeo be slain, say I, or if not, no. Brief sounds determine my weal or woe.
I saw the wound I saw with mine eyes. Your eyes were oppressed. The bloody, piteous mark. All the dog with blood. I swooned at the sight.
Oh, break my heart. Poor bankrupt, break at once.
Oh. Oh, Tybalt, the best friend that I ever had. The day that I should live to see thee dead.
What storm is this that blows so contrary? Is Romeo slaughtered, and is Tybalt dead?
My dear loved cousin, my dear lord.
Then dreadful trumpets sound the general doom, for who is living if those two are gone?
Tybalt is dead. Romeo that killed him, he is banished.
Did Romeo's hand shed Tybalt's blood?
Alas, the day it did.
Serpent heart, hid with a flowering face. Did ever a dragon keep so fair a cave? Beautiful tyrant, fiend angelical, dove-feathered raven, wolfish ravening lamb, despised substance of divinest show, just opposite to what thou justly seem'st. A damned saint. An honorable villain.
Is ever a book containing such vile matter so fairly bound?
how that deceit should dwell in such a gorgeous palace.
Oh, men, I forsworn all knots, all dissemblers. These sorrows make me old.
Shame come to Romeo! Blistered be thy tongue for such a wish! He was not born to shame. Upon his brow is shame ashamed to sit, for 'tis a throne where honor may be crowned, sole monarch of the universal earth. Oh, what a beast was I to chide at him!
Will you speak well of him that killed your cousin?
Shall I speak ill of him that is my husband?
Ah, my poor lord, what tongue shall smooth my name
when I, thy 3 hours' wife, have mangled it? Wherefore, villain, didst thou kill my cousin?
That villain cousin would have killed my husband. My husband lives, but slaughtered Tybalt, and Tybalt is dead, but would have slain my husband.
All this is comfort. Wherefore weep I then? Tybalt is dead, and Romeo banished. That banishment, that one word banishment, hath slain 10,000 Tybalts. Tybalt's death was woe enough if it had ended there. Romeo is banished. To speak that word is father, mother, Tybalt, Romeo, Juliet, all slain, all dead. Romeo is banished? There is no end, no limit. Measure bound in that word's depth, that can well sound. Where is my father and my mother, nurse?
Weeping and wailing over Tybalt's corpse, shall I bring you thither?
Wash they his wounds with tears. Mine shall be spent when there I ride for Romeo's banishment. Come, court, you are beguiled, both you and I, for Romeo's exile. Come, nurse, my wedding bed, and death, not Romeo, take my maidenhead.
No, hie you to your chamber. I'll find Romeo. I wot well where he is. Hie you to yourself. Hie you to your chamber. I must see him.
I'll bid him come to take his last farewell. Romeo, come forth. Come forth, thou fearful man, affliction is enamored. Hark, thou art wedded to calamity.
Father, what news? What is the prince's doom?
A gentler judgment hath banished from his lips. Not body's death, body's banishment.
Huh? Banishment? Be merciful. Say, death for exile hath more terror in his look, much more than death.
Do not say banishment.
Touch from Verona art thou banished. Be patient, for the world is broad and wide.
There is no world without Verona walls,
but purgatory, torture, hell itself. Hence, banishment is banished from the world, and world's exile is death. Then banishment is death, misturned, calling death banishment. Thou cuts my head off with a golden axe and smilest upon the stroke that murders me.
Oh, death, sick! Oh, rude and faithfulness, thy fault our law calls death. But the kind prince, taking thy part, hath rushed aside the law and turned that black word death to banishment. This is dear mercy, and thou seest it not.
'Tis torture and not mercy. Heaven is here, where Juliet lives, and every cat and dog and little mouse, every unworthy thing, live here in heaven and may look on her. But Romeo may not. More validity, more honorable state, more courtship lives in carrion flies than Romeo. They may seize on the white wonder that is dear Juliet's hand and steal immortal blessings from her lips. But Romeo may not. He
Stay a while! Stand in front of my study, by and by God's will, what sinfulness is this?
I call my papa, who knocks so hard? What's coming? What's your will?
Let me come in, and you shall know my errand. I come from Lady Juliet.
Welcome.
Oh, friar, oh, holy friar. Tell me, where is my lady's lord? Where is Romeo?
There. On the ground. With his own tears made to drop.
He is even in my mistress' case. Oh, woeful sympathy! Oh, pity's predicament! Even so lies she, weeping and blubbering, blubbering and weeping.
Rise up and be a man! For Juliet's sake, rise and stand!
Thus speaks thou of Juliet?
How is it with her? Doth she not think me an old murderer, and I stain the childhood of our joy with blood removed but little from her own? Where is she, and how doth she, and whence is my concealed lady to our council above?
She says nothing, but falls on her bed, then stands up again. Then Tybalt cries, and Romeo calls, and down falls again.
Since that name, shot from the deadly level of stun, did murder her, and that name's cursed hand murder her kinsman.
Friar, tell me, in what vile part of this anatomy did my name was?
Tell me that I recite the hateful name!
Hold thy desperate hand! Art thou a man? Thy form cries out, thou art thou? Hast faith. By my holy order, I thought thy disposition better comfort. Hast thou slain Tybalt? And wilt thou slay thyself? And slay thy lady too, that lives in thee by doing damned hate upon thyself? What? Rouse thee, man, thy Juliet is alive for whose dear sake thou wast but lately dead. There art thou happy. Tybalt would slay thee, but thou slewest Tybalt. There art thou happy too. The law that threatened death becomes thy friend, and turns that black word death to exile. There art thou happy. Of happy blessings lights upon thy face. Happiness courts thee in her best array, but like a misbehaved and sullen wind thou bounced upon thy fortune and thy love. Take heed, for such die miserable.
Things have fallen out, sir, so unluckily that we have had no time to move our daughter. Look you, she loved her kinsman Tybalt dearly, and so did I. Well, we were born to die. 'Tis very late, she'll not come down tonight. I promise you, but for your company, I would have been a bed an hour ago.
These times of woe afford no time to move. Madam, good night. Commend me to your daughter.
I will, and never mind early tomorrow. Tonight she's moved up to her heaviness.
Sir Paris, I will make a desperate tender of my child's love. I think she will be ruled in all respects by me. Nay more, I doubt it not. Wife, go you to her ere you go to bed. Acquaint her here of my son Paris's love, and bid her mark you me on Wednesday next. But soft, what day is this?
Monday, my lord.
Monday? Well, Wednesday is too soon. On Thursday let it be. On Thursday tell her she shall be married to this noble earl. Will you be ready? Do you like this haste? We'll keep no great ado, a friend or two. For hark you,
Tybalt being slain so late, it may be thought we held him carelessly, being our kinsman if we revel much.
Therefore we'll have some half a dozen friends, and there an end. But what say you to Thursday?
My lord, I would Thursday were tomorrow.
Why, get you gone, on Thursday be it then. Wife, go you to Juliet ere you go to bed. Prepare her against this wedding day. Farewell, my lord. Light to my chamber, ho! Before me it is so very, very late that we may call it early by and by. Good night.
Wilt thou be gone? It is not yet day. Who is the nightingale, and not the lark, that pierced the fearful hollow already? Nightly she sings on yon pomegranate tree. Believe me, love, it was the nightingale.
It was the lark, the herald of the morn, no nightingale. Look, love, what envious streaks can lace the severing clouds in yonder east. Night's candles are burnt out, and jocund day stands tiptoe on the misty mountain tops. I must be gone and live, or stay and die.
Yon light is not daylight. I know it, aye. It is some meteor that the sun exhales to be thee thy torchbearer and light thee on thy way to Mantua. Therefore stay yet. Thou needest not be gone.
Let me be taken.
Let me be put to death.
I'm content, so thou wilt have it so. I'll say yon ray is not the morning's eye, nor that is not the lark whose notes do beat the vaulty heaven so high above our heads. I have more care to stay than will to go.
Come, death, and welcome. Juliet, wills it so. How is my soul? Let's talk. It is not day.
It is. It is. High hands be gone. Away. It is the lark that sang so out of tune. Oh, now be gone. More light and light it grows.
More light and light, more dark and darker woes.
Nurse, your lady mother's come to the chamber.
Day's broke. Be wary. Out. In the window, let day in and let life out.
Farewell. One kiss and I'll descend.
Art thou gone so? Love, lord, I, husband, friend, I must hear from thee every day within the hour. For in a minute there are many days. Oh, by this count, I shall be much in years ere I begin. Behold, my Romeo.
Farewell. I will omit no opportunity that may convey my greetings, love to thee.
Oh, thinkest thou we shall ever meet again?
I doubt it not. And all these woes shall serve as sweet discourses in our time to come.
God, with an ill divining soul, methinks I see thee, thou now art below as one dead. In the bottom of a tomb, either my eyesight fails or thou lookest pale.
And trust me, love, in my eyes so do you. Dry sorrow drinks our blood. Adieu. Adieu.
Oh, fortune, fortune. All men call thee fickle. If thou art fickle, what dost thou with him that is renowned for faith? Be fickle, fortune, but then I hope thou wilt not keep him long, but send him back.
Oh, daughter, are you up?
Who is it that calls? Is it my lady mother? Is she not down so late, or up so early? What unaccustomed cause procures her hither?
But how now, Juliet?
Madame, I am not well.
Evermore weeping for your cousin's death?
What, with the washing from his grave of tears?
And if thou couldst not make him live. Therefore, have done. Some grief shows much of love, yet much of grief shows still some want of wit.
Yet let me weep for such a feeling loss.
Shall you feel the loss?
feeling so the lost cannot choose but ever weep with friend.
Well, girl, thou witness not so much for his death, as that the villain lives which slaughtered him.
What villain, madame?
That same villain, Romeo.
God pardon him, I do with all my heart. And yet, no man like he doth read my heart.
That is because the traitor murderer lives. We will have vengeance for it? Fear thou not. Then weep no more. I'll send to one in Mantua, where that same banished runagate doth live. I'll give him such an unaccustomed dram, that he shall soon keep Tybalt company. And then, I hope, thou wilt be satisfied. But now, I'll tell thee joyful tidings, girl.
And joy comes well in such a needy time. What are they? Have a seat, your ladyship.
Well, thou hast a careful father, one who, put thee from thy heaviness, hath sorted out a Sunday of joy that thou expected not, nor I looked not for.
And happy time, madame. What day is that?
Marry, my child, early next Thursday morn, a gallant young and noble gentleman, the County Paris, at St. Peter's Church, shall happily make thee there a joyful bride.
Not by St. Peter's Church, and Peter too, he shall not make me there a joyful bride. I wonder at this haste that I must wed ere he that should be my husband comes to woo. I pray you, madame, tell my lord and father I will not marry yet, and when I do, it shall be Romeo, whom you know I hate. These are news indeed.
Well, here comes your father. Tell him so yourself, and see how he will take it at your hands.
How now, conduit girl? Why, still in tears? Evermore showering? How now, wife, have you delivered to her our decree?
Aye, sir, but she will not. She gives you thanks. I would the fool were married to her grave.
Soft. Take me with you. Take me with you, wife. How? Will she not? Doth she not give us thanks? Is she not proud? Doth she not count her blessed, unworthy as she is, that we have wrought so worthy a gentleman to be her bridegroom?
Not proud you have, but thankful that you have. Proud can I never be of what I hate, but thankful even for hate that is meant well.
How now, chop logic! What is this proud? And I thank you, and I thank you not, and yet not proud. Mistress Minion, you thank me no thankings, nor proud me no proud, but get thee to St. Peter's Church with Paris on Thursday next, or I'll drag thee on a hurdle thither! Out, you green sickness carrion! Out, you baggage! You tallow face!
My father, are you mad?
Good father, I beseech you on my knees, hear me with patience, but to speak a word.
Hang thee, young baggage, disobedient wretch! I tell thee what. Get thee to church on Thursday, or never after look me in the face. Speak not, reply not, do not answer me. My fingers itch. Wife, we scarce thought us blessed that God had lent us but this only child, but now I see this one is one too much, and that we have a curse in having her. Out on her, children.
God in heaven bless her, you are to blame, my lord, to read her so.
And why, my lady wisdom, hold your tongue, good prudence, smatter with your gossips, go!
I speak no treason.
Oh, God, ye go then!
May not one speak?
Peace, you mumbling fool! Utter your gravity over a gossip's bowl, for here we need it not!
We're too hot!
God's bread, it makes me mad. Day, night, hour, tide, time, work, play, alone, in company, still my only care hath been to have her matched. And now, having provided
a noble gentleman, of fine parentage, youthful and nobly trained, stuffed, as they say, with honorable parts, proportioned as one's thought would wish a man. And then to have a wretched, puling fool, a whining mammoth in her fortune's tender, to answer, "I'll not wed, I cannot love, I am too young, I pray thee, pardon me." But if thou wilt not wed, I'll pardon thee. Graze where you will, you shall not house with me. Look to it, think on it, I do not use to jest. Thursday is near. Lay hand on heart, advise. And thou be mine, I'll give thee to my friend. And thou be not, hang, beg, starve, die in the streets, for I'll never acknowledge thee, nor what is mine shall never do thee good. Trust to it, bethink you, I'll not be forsworn.
Is there no pity sitting in the clouds that sees into the bottom of my grief? Oh, sweet my mother, cast me not away. Delay this marriage for a month, a week, or thou wilt not make the bridal bed in that dear monument where Tybalt lies.
Talk not to me, nor not speak word. Do as thou wilt, for I have done with thee.
Oh, nurse, how shall this be prevented? What sayst thou? Hast thou not a word of joy? Some comfort, nurse.
Faith, there it is. Romeo is banished, and all the world to nothing. And should he never come back to challenge you, it must needs be myself. I think you should marry with the county. He is a wonderful gentleman, and the second match excels your first. Or if it does not, your first is dead, or as it were. You hear and you no use of him.
Speakest thou from thy heart?
And from my soul too, or else beshrew them both.
Well, thou hast comforted me marvelous much. Go in. Tell my lady mother I am gone, having displeased my father, to Lawrence cell, to make confession and to be absolved.
Mary, I will, and this is wisely done.
Ancient damnation! Oh, most wicked fiend! Is it more sin to wish me thus forsworn or to dispraise my lord, with that same tongue which she hath praised him so many thousand times? Go, counsel. Thou and my bosom henceforth shall be twain, all to the friar, to know his remedy. If all else fail, myself have power to die.
On Thursday,
sir, the time is very short.
My father Cabiel will have it so, and I am nothing slow to lack his haste.
You say you do not know the lady's mind, but even as this course, I like it not.
Immoderately she weeps for Tybalt's death, and therefore I have little talked of love, for Venus' smile is not in a house of tears. Now, sir, her father counts it dangerous that she doth give her sorrow so much sway, and in his wisdom haste our marriage. To stop the inundation of her tears, which too much minded by herself alone, may be put from her by society. Now you know the reason of this haste.
Look, sir, here comes the lady towards my south.
How?
happily met, my lady and my boy.
That may be, sir, when I may meet a wife.
But maybe must be love on Thursday next.
What must be shall be.
Not deserve that. Poor soul, but this is a refuse of tears.
The tears have got small victory by that, for it was bad enough before their spite.
The wrongs did more than tears that before.
That is no slander, sir, which is truth. And when I spake it to my face.
Thy face is mine, and thou slandered it.
It may be so, for it is not mine own.
Are you at leisure, holy father, or shall I come to you at evening mass?
Is my leisure service me, pence and doctor, now?
My lord, we must entreat the time alone. God shield us your disturbed devotion. Juliet, on Thursday early I will rouse thee. Till then, adieu, and keep this holy kiss.
Shut the door, and when thou hast done so, come weep with me, past hope, past cure, past help.
Juliet, I already know thy grief. It
strains me back to the compass of my wit. Here thou must and nothing make prorogate, but Thursday next be married to this country.
Well, tell me not, friar, that thou hearest of this, unless thou may tell me how I may prevent it. If in thy wisdom thou canst give no help, then do thou but call my resolution wise. And with this knife, I will help it presently.
Hold! Daughter, I do spy a kind hope. This craves as desperate as an execution, as that is desperate which he would.
Rather than marry County Paris, thou hast the strength and will to slay thyself, then it is likely thou wilt undertake a thing like death, which I have waited to name, and hopest with death himself to escape from it, and if thou darest, I'll give leave of me.
Well, bid me leap rather than marry Paris off the battlements from yonder tower. Or bid me go into a new-made grave and hide me with a dead man in his shroud. Things that to have heard them told have made me tremble, and I will do them without fear or doubt to live an unstained wife for my sweet love.
Oh, then. Go on. Be there. Give consent to marry her. Wednesday is tomorrow. Tomorrow night, look, that thou lie, let not thine heart play with thee in thy chamber. Then in bed, take thou this phial, and the disc distilled with the cord, break thou off. And presently, with all thy veins shall run in cold, and in ground thee, for no pulse, no water. No breath nor testify thy lips. The roses in thy lips and cheeks shall fade to paly ashes. Thy eyes' windows fall like death, shall heat it up to day of light. Each part deprived of temple memory shall stiff and stark and cold appear like death, and in this barred likeness of strong death, thou shalt continue to. Yeah, I've been awake as from a pleasant sleep. Now, when the bridegroom comes to rouse thee from thy slumber, there art thou dead. Dead as the manner of our country is, thou shalt be born in that same ancient vault where all the kindred of the capitalists lie. In the meantime, against thyself to wait, shall Romeo find my letters know our drift, and hither shall he come, and he and I will watch thy waking, and that very night will Romeo bear thee hence to Mantua.
Oh, give me, tell me not to fear.
Hope yet you God be strong, prosperous, and this resolve will send a friar with speed to Mantua with my letters to thy lord.
Love give me strength, and strength shall help avail. Farewell, dear father.
Friar Lawrence?
Aye, forsooth.
Well, he may chance to do some good on her. A peevish, self-willed harlotry it is.
See where she comes shirt with merry look.
How now, my headstrong, where have you been gadding?
Where have learned me to repent the sin of disobedient opposition to you and your behest, and am adjoined by holy Lawrence to fall prostrate here and beg your pardon. Pardon, I beseech you, henceforth I am ever ruled by you.
Send for the county, go tell him of this. I'll have this knot knit up tomorrow morning.
I met the youthful lord at Lawrence cell, and gave him what becomed of love. I might not overstep the bounds of modesty.
Why, I am glad on it. This is well. Stand up. This is as it should be. Let me see the county. Aye, Mary, go, I say, and fetch him hither. Now, for God, this reverend holy friar, our whole city is much bound to him.
Nurse, will you go with me to my closet and help me sort out such needful ornaments as you think fit to furnish me tomorrow?
No, it's not till Thursday. There's time now.
Go, nurse, go with her. We'll to church tomorrow.
Shall we short our provision? Tis now or never.
Tush, I will stir about. All things shall be well. I warrant thee, wife. Go thou to Juliet. Help to deck up her. I'll not to bed tonight. Let me alone. I'll play the housewife for this once. What ho, they're all forth. Well, I will walk myself down to County Paris to prepare him up against tomorrow. My heart is wondrous light since this same wayward girl is so reclaimed.
Aye, those attires are best. But gentle nurse, I pray you, leave me to myself tonight. For I have need of many orisons to make the heavens smile upon my fate. For, well thou knowest, it is cross and full of sin.
What? Are you busy? Who needs my help?
No, madame. We have called such necessaries as are beholden for our state tomorrow. But I pray you, leave me to myself now, and let the nurse this night sit up with you. For I am sure you have your hands full in this so sudden business.
Good night. Get thee to bed and rest, for thou hast need.
Farewell. God knows when you shall meet again. I have a faint, cold fear that thrills through my veins, that almost freezes up the heat of life. I'll call him back again to comfort me. Nurse! What should she do here? A dismal scene, I needs must act alone. Come, vile. What if this mixture did not work at all? Shall I be merry then, tomorrow morning? No. No, this shall prevent it. I'll go there. How if, when I am laid into the tomb, I wake before the time that Romeo comes to redeem me? There's a fearful point. Shall I not then be stifled in the vault to whose foul mouth no healthsome air breathes in, and there die, strangled, ere my Romeo comes? If I live, is it not very like the horrible conceit of death and night, along with the terror of the place, as in a vault, an ancient receptacle, where, for these many hundred years, the bones of all my buried ancestors are packed, where bloody Tybalt, yet but green in earth, lies festering in his shroud, where, as they say, at some hours of the night, spirits resort. Oh, if I wake, shall I not be distraught, environed by all these hideous fears, and madly play with my forefather's joints, and pluck the mangled Tybalt from his shroud, and in this rage, with some great kinsman's bone, as with a club, dash out my desperate brains? Oh, look, methinks I see my cousin's ghost, seeking out Romeo, that did spit his body upon a rapier's point. Stay!
what, mistress?
Juliet!
Fast, I warrant her.
She.
Mary, and amen, how sound is she asleep?
Fie, you slut of bed!
Why, love, why, lady, why, love, why, bride?
Now, what? Dressed and down again? Mistress? Mistress?
Alas! Alas, help! Help! Alas, the day, help!
What noise is here?
Oh, lamentable day!
What is the matter?
Look! Look!
Me, my child, my only life. If I look up, or I will die with thee. Help, help, call help.
For shame, bring Juliet forth. Her lord is come.
She's dead. She's deceased. She's dead. Alack the day, she's dead.
Let me see her out.
Alas, she's cold. Her blood is settled and her joints are stiff.
Life and these lips have long been separated. Death lies on her like an untimely frost on the sweetest flower of all the fields.
Oh, lamentable day.
Oh, poor death. Death that hath taken her hence to make me well ties up my tongue and will not let me.
Come, is the bride ready to go to church?
Ready to go, but never to return. Oh, son, the night before thy wedding day hath death lain with thy wife. There she lies, flower as she was, deflowered by him. Death is my son-in-law. Death is my heir. My daughter he hath wedded. I will die, and all will be his. Life, living, all is death's.
Have I thought long to see this morning's face? And doth it give me such a sight as this? Accursed, unhappy, wretched, painful day. This miserable hour that ever time saw, the lasting labor of this woman. But one poor and loving child. The one thing to rejoice in the lost, but cruel death hath cast it from my sight.
Oh, lamentable day,
most woeful day that ever I did behold.
Peace! Ho, for shame! Confusion's cure lives not in these confusions.
Heaven and yourself had part of this, fair maid. Now heaven hath all, and all the better it is for the maid. She's not well married that lives married long, but she's best married that dies married young. Dry up your tears and stick your rosemary on this fair corpse, and as the custom is, in all her best array, bear her to church.
All things that we ordain festival turn from their office to black funeral. Our instruments to melancholy bells. Our wedding cheer to a sad burial feast. Our solemn hymns to sullen dirges change. Our bridal flowers to serve for a buried horse, and all things change them to the contrary.
Sir, go you men. Now, go with him and go, Sir Paris, everyone prepare to follow this fair corpse into her grave. The heavens you low are pining for some ill, move them no more by crossing their high will.
I may trust the flattering truth of sleep. My dreams presage some joyful news at hand. My bosom's lord
throne. And all this day, an unaccustomed spirit lifts me above the ground with cheerful thoughts.
I dreamt my lady came and found me dead. Strange dream that gives a dead man leave to think, and breathed such life with kisses in my lips that I revived and was an emperor.
News from Verona! How now, Bergoglio? How does my lady? Is my father well?
How fares my Juliet? That I ask again, for nothing can be ill if she be well.
And she is well, and nothing can be ill. Her body sleeps in Capel's monument, and her immortal part of the angels lives. I saw her laid low in her kindred's vault, and presently took post to tell it you. Oh, pardon me for bringing you these ill news, since you did leave it to my office.
Is it even so? I defy you, stars.
Thou knowest my lodging. Fetch me ink and paper, and hire post horses. I will hence tonight.
Well, Juliet, I will lay with thee tonight. Let's see for means.
Oh, mister, thou art swift to enter in the thoughts of desperate men. I do remember an apothecary, and hereabouts he dwells, which late I noted, in tattered weeds with overwhelming brows. Sharp misery had worn him to the bones. Noting this penury, to myself I said, an amend need of poison now, whose sale is present death in Mantua. Here lives a caitiff wreck would sell at him. Oh, this same thought did but forerun my need, and this same needy man must sell at me.
What ho, apothecary?
Who calls so loud?
Come hither, man. I see that thou art poor. Hold. There is 40 ducats. Let me have a dram of poison, such soon-speeding gear as will disperse itself through all the veins that the life-weary taker may fall dead.
Such mortal drugs I have, but Mantuan's law is death to any he that utters them.
Art thou so bare and full of wretchedness and fear'st to die? Famine is in thy cheeks, need and oppression starveth in thine eyes. The world affords no law to make thee rich. Then be not poor, but break it, and take this.
My poverty, not my will, consents.
Pay thy poverty and not thy will. Come, cordial, and not poison, go with me to Juliet's grave, for there must I use thee.
Holy Franciscan Prior, Brother Ho!
This seems to be the voice of Friar John Walton from Mantua. What, says Romeo? Or if it's my dear Pagan, be his letter.
Going to find a veteran brother of one of our order to associate me. Came in the city visiting the sick, and finding him, the searchers of the town, suspecting that we both were in a house where the infectious custom would reign, sealed up the doors and would not let us forth, so that my speed to Mantua there was stayed.
Who bear my letter with? To Romeo.
I could not send it. Here it is again, nor get a messenger to bring it to you. So fearful were they of infection.
By my brotherhood, this letter was not nice, but full of charge of dear report, and the neglecting it may do much danger. Friar John, go ahead.
Thank you.
beauty's ensign yet is crimson in thy lips and in thy cheeks. And death's pale flag is not advanced there. Ah, oh, dear Juliet, why art thou yet so fair? Shall I believe that unsubstantial death is amorous, and that the lean, abhorred monster keeps thee here in dark to be his paramour? For fear of that, I still will stay with thee, and never from this palace of dim night depart again. Here, here will I remain with worms that are thy chambermaids. Oh, here will I set up my everlasting rest and shake the yoke of inauspicious stars from this world-weary flesh. Eyes, look your last. Arms, take your last embrace. And lips, oh, you doors of breath, seal with a righteous kiss the deepest bargain to engrossing death. Unsavory guide, thou desperate pilot, now at once run on the dashing rocks thy seasick, weary bark. Here's to my love.
slain on them to make thee die with the sword.
Thy lips are warm.
Nay, noise. But I will be brief. Oh, happy Agrippa. This is thy sheath. Than this of Juliet and her romance.